Today on BRStv, it's everything you ever wanted to know about live rock. Hey guys, my name is Ryan. Welcome to another week of the BRS 160, where every week we do our best to help you guys, members of the reefing community, enjoy your tanks and find new ways to explore the hobby. We do that by following the setup and progression of this 160-gallon reef tank. This week we're going to explore everything related to live rock, starting with why we use it, benefits of wet and dry rock, discuss the surface area and porosity and curing, and finish with selecting and curing the rock for the BRS 160. In reef aquariums, we use live rock for a few main purposes: aesthetic appeal, habitat for fish and corals, as well as probably the most important element, filtering the tank. Every time I explain the setup of a reef tank to someone new, the first thing they ask is, where's the filter? Filter is one of those terms that has a lot of meanings in the reef tank. By definition, filtering really means removing something, and there is some equipment on a tank, like filter socks and protein skimmers, that are capable of removing waste from the tank, as well as medias like carbon, GFO, and zeovit, which are capable of filtering the water and capturing various contaminants. In relation to live rock filtering the tank, what we're really talking about is the rock and the bacteria it hosts on the surface of the rock to not necessarily remove the elements from the tank, but instead process or convert broken down food and fish waste in the form of very toxic ammonia into much safer nitrite and nitrate. It's also possible in the right conditions for the rock and its host bacteria to perform similarly to a true filter by further converting the nitrate into nitrogen gas, which bubbles out of the tank and effectively removes the ammonia and its process components from the tank for good. This entire process of filtering the toxic ammonia is commonly referred to as a nitrogen cycle. We're going to cover this and how to cycle a new tank properly in depth in just a few weeks. For this episode, it's just important to know that live rock more or less serves as a surface area for the bacteria to populate on and filter your tank for you. There are two fundamental types of live rock, with wet and dry. Wet rock comes from the ocean and has life on it, including bacteria, algae, possible a coral or two makes it, as well as crabs or other critters on really fresh live rock. Biggest advantage to wet rock is it's the quickest method to get a tank up and running and look established. The surface of the live rock tends to have a lot of coralline and an established biofilm, which makes it more difficult for algae common with new tanks to take hold. It just looks nice day one. If getting a tank up as fast as possible is a priority, wet rock is your best option. There are three major categories within wet live rock, with boat rock, air rock, and aquacultured rock. Boat rock is packed wet in a box, often with some wet newspaper, and shipped from countries on the other side of the world, like Fiji, on a container ship. Whole process from collection to distribution to retail stores and delivery to you is often 6 to 8 weeks. For this reason, they have to scrub off most of the life before packing it or will rot in transit. Boat rock is live in the general sense of the word, but because it's been out of the ocean for so long, I wouldn't expect to see anything real special on it other than some coralline. Strange component of this is a lot of online vendors will have you use overnight delivery from them, which, unless the weather is extreme, doesn't make a lot of sense and kind of seems like a waste of money. Air rock is rock that was shipped direct from places like Fiji via plane, stops in LA where it's routed to distributors, and often directly to customers overnight. This means the rock's only been out of the water for a few days and they leave a lot more life on it, with tons of coralline algae in various colors and possible hitchhiker corals and critters. When somebody's thinking about live rock, it's air rock they have in mind. So how do you tell the difference between boat rock and air rock? In person, it's really easy because air rock looks incredible. Ordering online, it can be a lot harder to identify, but one sure sign of boat rock or old air rock is a low price of less than $5 a pound. It isn't cheap to fly 50-pound boxes of rock from Fiji halfway around the planet, and a reason a vast majority of the live rock in our industry is shipped on container ships. One other option is aquacultured rock, which is various types of rock dumped in the ocean where it's allowed to soak, often for years before it's covered in all kinds of life and shipped to you. The rock is almost always a calcium carbonate-based rock like limestone or some form of man-made rock. This means there's very little impact on the ocean and environment. There's a lot of rock in the world's oceans, but we're not going to be able to keep pulling it out forever, so responsible, sustainable solutions like this are pretty attractive. You can get it in both boat and air deliveries, and it's pretty much indistinguishable from your typical Fiji premium. You can also get aquacultured rock from Florida, which is primarily limestone cultured in the Florida Keys. Because it's local, many of the providers will actually ship it to you in bags of water via airport to airport, which really provides an unprecedented amount of life on the rock. As someone who's purchased this type of rock in the past, it looks ultra cool day one, but I would like to mention that this rock comes with a lot of filter feeding organisms, which look really cool when you get them, but most are destined to die without some pretty advanced feeding techniques. So 90% of the time, it's no different than typical live rock in 6+ months, and might not be worth the price premium. Because it is shipped in bags of water and so fresh, you're going to find a lot of really cool organisms as well as more pest organisms like gorilla crabs, mantis shrimp, isopods, bristle worms, and funky algae. This is where dry live rock comes in. This is either just wet live rock from the ocean that's been allowed to dry out, limestone rock, or dry man-made rock. Well, wet live rock is the most popular with newer reefers who are often in a hurry to get their tanks set up. Dry rock is more popular with seasoned reefers who want to eliminate some of the mistakes of the past, as well as constantly looking for ways to save a few bucks in this fairly expensive hobby. The thing about wet live rock is it comes not only with desirable live elements, but also impossible to remove pests as well. Most common are funky algae, aptasia, fireworms, red bugs, parasitic snails, flatworms, isopods, and flukes. Many of these nasty organisms cause reefers a lot of headaches, hurt or kill livestock, and very commonly result in a complete tank teardown. Once you go through the hassle of starting your tank all over, you're going to do whatever you can to avoid putting these things back into your tank again, and why dry rock is so popular with seasoned reefers. Basically, everything on dry rock is dead and can be considered safe, and some curing process can absolutely assure that. This means you're starting clean, and the only pests that go into the tank are those that you put in there yourself. Most commonly on the base of corals added to the tank. It's unlikely you'll completely avoid ever introducing any pests to the tank, but starting with dry rock will absolutely limit them. Dry rock is also lower cost by the pound, doesn't have all that water weight, and in most cases ships completely free, which in the end can easily make it cost half as much. This is particularly true with Pukani, which is very light. To give you an idea of value, we put 40 pounds of wet Fiji in this tank and 40 pounds of Pukani. It's pretty obvious you only need about half as much rock to fill the same space, which makes it a lot more affordable and pretty compelling. Dry rock's commonly available in a few different types with Pukani, Fiji, Shelf, Branch, Reef Saver, and Walt Smith's new Reef Rock 2.1. Pukani's my personal favorite because of its unique structure and it's super light. So even though it costs a few bucks more, it's likely the lowest cost option out there. Pukani's also the easiest to manipulate with tools and create a cool structure, something we'll cover in detail in next week's aquascaping video. Reef Saver is a dry calcium carbonate based limestone rock mined from the ground in Florida in areas with low pH aquifers that tunnel these cool pore structures into the rock. One of the obvious advantages here is sustainability and lack of impact on the ocean's reefs. The second is ease of aquascaping. The edges of this rock fit together seamlessly. Fiji is just a staple in reefing and historically the most popular rock used in aquariums. The Tonga Shelf and Branch are more specialty rocks used to create some unique looks that meet specific desires and honestly pretty hard to work with. A newer entry into the market is the Reef Rock 2.1 from Walt Smith, which is a completely sustainable man-made rock. One of the differences between this and the other sustainable options like Reef Saver is this rock comes in a purple color, which immediately gives a perception of an established reef tank once it's underwater. The darker coating is smoother and seems much less likely to grow algae common in new tanks. I was a bit hesitant with this rock at first, but it's come a long way and I think it just might be a big component of future reefing because it really combines the benefits of dry and wet rock. It comes pest-free so you know you're starting clean. The surface seems to be really algae resistant and most of us here at BRS were really surprised how sharp it looks once it's in the tank and under reef lighting. One of the things people discuss a lot when they talk rock is available surface area and porosity, because these things basically represent the amount of area or habitat the beneficial bacteria have to populate your tank and quickly and efficiently process ammonia into safer elements. While surface area and porosity are often mistakenly used interchangeably, they typically represent very different things. Most of the time when people reference porosity with live rock, they're discussing the visual hole network in the rock. For instance, visually, a piece of Pukani or Reef Saver is much more porous than a piece of Fiji. This visual element of porosity does play a role in total surface area. For instance, this round ping pong ball has about 7 square inches of total surface area. This bio ball, which is about the same size, was designed to increase surface area and has about 23 square inches of surface area. This single ball of marine pier, which has this network of tiny holes, is visually much more porous than both of these two and has 240 square feet of surface area captured in this small ball. So to some degree, it is possible to make a visual assessment on the available surface area. However, surface area has a more impactful component that happens at the microscopic level. Surface area measures the total available surface and a bit more difficult to understand. For instance, this tablespoon of activated carbon might not look like it has much surface area and visually isn't drastically different size than the balls we just referenced, but at the microscopic level it has a vast internal pore network which equals the same total area as an entire football field. That means this tablespoon of carbon has 170,000 feet of total available surface area. It's hard to imagine. To help shed some light on this in relation to reefing in the various rocks, we sent out 100 gram samples of each rock and a sample of that marine pure biomedia to a lab to perform multi-point BET surface area testing. Fiji and marine pure were clear winners in this regard with 1.14 and 1.06 square meters of surface area per gram. Reef Saver and Pukani were virtually tied at 0.515 and 0.512, and Tonga came in at a pretty dismal 0.10 square meters of surface area per gram. This means a rock you select can have a big impact on the total surface area for the bacteria to populate and filter your tank. To add one more layer to this, the lab has to crush the samples up to perform the testing, so it doesn't test the true availability of the rock's internal pore network, meaning how far and how easily the water can penetrate the rock, which greatly increases the available surface area. One of the ways to get a general idea of how far and how easily water can penetrate the rock and be absorbed by the rock's internal pore network is just to weigh it dry and wet to see how much water it soaks up. We soaked these samples overnight. The marine pure was a clear winner and was able to absorb 2,400 grams of water, the Pukani 380, Fiji 210, Tonga 90, and the Reef Saver just 60. So while the crushed up samples of Pukani and Reef Saver had about the same surface area, the actual rock is able to absorb over 6 times the volume of water, which is a pretty good indicator that Pukani is going to have significantly more surface area, and water can penetrate and travel through the rock easier, which could possibly make it a better option for those of you hoping to use rock to convert that nitrate into nitrogen gas and complete the ideal nitrogen cycle. The real winner in this regard was a marine pure biomedia. Even though it just looks like a large block, it's incredibly porous, both visually as well as tested by the lab, and it was able to absorb as much as 40 times as much water. To help demonstrate the availability of this material's available pore network, we glued a plumbing fitting to the top and ran some tap water through it. You can see the water just flows freely through the entire brick. The beauty of this is you can really pick up any rock you want, including those minimalist aquascapes with very little rock in the tank itself, and throw some of this marine pure or even some rock like Pukani and Fiji in the sump and know your tank has ample habitat for the beneficial bacteria in the tank. Once you've selected your rock, you'll need to cure it. Curing the rock is often confused with cycling the tank because they share some similarities and in some cases can be done at the same time. Curing the rock is the process of getting the rock ready for the tank and is very different for wet and dry rock. With wet rock, there's always going to be some die-off from the organisms that don't handle the transport well. Curing wet rock starts with giving each piece a quick rinse in a bucket of salt water to rinse off anything dead, loose, general muck, or algae. The rock has very obvious decay or large patches of algae, you're going to want to take a brush to it and scrub it off. These OXO brushes work well for this type of thing. After that, it's really just putting the rock in heated salt water and allowing ample time for whatever's going to die off in the rock to do so before you start adding livestock to the tank. You can do this in the tank itself or in containers like these brute trash cans. Either way, you'll want to completely drain the tank and replace with new salt water once the cure is done. The big question is how long and do you want to put light on the rock during the cure? Without light, some corals and coralline algae will die. However, the process of curing the rock creates a lot of nutrients in the water which will promote algae in the tank and get your tank off to a bad start. If you paid extra for air rock or other really nice stuff, I'd probably want to put some light on the tank during this time, but I'd try to keep it to shorter periods or lower intensity. It's hard to say how much die-off you'll have, but I'd say the process can take as little as a couple weeks or over a month. Watching nutrient levels like ammonia and nitrate are the best bet. Once they stop rising, it's likely things have stopped dying. If you got boat live rock and there really isn't a whole lot of life on it to begin with other than small patches of coralline, I think I'd personally cure it without light in these brute bins to avoid any algae growth and monitor the nutrients the same way. Once the cure is over, discard the water and start the tank with fresh salt water. Many of the old pros in the hobby will use this method and cure or soak the rock for 3 to 6 months before adding it to the tank. That's certainly not required to have a successful reef tank, but will absolutely help get all the organics off the surface of the rock, as well as likely allow a vast majority of the pest hitchhikers and algae to die off. This still isn't 100% effective at preventing pests, but it will reduce them for sure. With dry rock, the process is somewhat different. The Fiji, Pukani, and Tonga are all out of the ocean and dried out, which means they have dried up organisms on them which will need to break down during the curing process. This is particularly true with the Pukani, which will often have a lot of sponges or other organisms in the crevices. While these things break down, just like any other type of organics in the tank, like fish food or waste, it will add nutrients to the water, like ammonia and the resulting nitrate, as well as things like phosphate and the yellowing color pigments. This is sometimes confused with the rock leaching nutrients into the water during the cure, but more accurately, it's just these organics breaking down that are on the surface of the rock. Since this type of rock doesn't need light, I'm going to do the cure in a dark container like the Brute trash cans to prevent algae growth. It'll help speed the process up if you add some good flow to the container and heat the water. How long this takes is again really variable from weeks to over a month, but the best way to identify when the cure is done for sure is to monitor nutrients like ammonia and nitrate. Once they stop rising and stabilize, you can consider the rock cured. Some reefers will take this a step further and do a bleach or acid cure. The bleach will help oxidize or destroy organic matter like algae and sponges, and the acid will mostly dissolve the exposed layer of the rock and loosen some of the organics like algae so you don't have to wait for them to break down. There's some obvious safety issues with playing around with acid and bleach, and the main benefit is really shaving some time off the cure. Even after this process, you're going to want to continue the dry rock cure for a couple of weeks minimum in heated salt water to allow the rock to form a solid biofilm, which will help prevent algae from taking hold. With the ReefSaver and Walt Smith's new Reef Rock 2.1, we really don't need to be as concerned about the organic end of the cure because ReefSaver is mined rock and the Reef Rock is man-made, so there should be little to no organics on either, but I still absolutely recommend soaking it in heated salt water to get any of the dirt or other contaminants off. This also gives the rock time to form that important biofilm on the surface of the rock to help fight against algae growth. This is particularly important with the ReefSaver, which has a bright white rough surface that algae seems to like in brand new tanks. The Reef Rock 2.1, however, has a dark purple surface, which is really smooth. Algae has a harder time taking hold and spreading on this surface, but I'd still soak it or cure it for a few weeks before use. I'd also like to note that a lot of these curing processes can create quite an odor and really stink as the organics die off. A bag of basically any type of carbon should solve that completely. So what do we select for the BRS160? I've had a couple hundred pounds of Pukani curing and ready to go for months. And this is really my favorite type of rock for a whole variety of reasons, including looks, density, porosity, ease of some really cool aquascaping techniques, and it's pest-free. But I think it's time that we tried something different, and we're gonna go with the Reef Rock 2.1. I think this rock really has a future in our industry. I like the lack of organics, the sustainability of the product, low to no impact on the oceans, and I think it's going to be the quickest way to get an attractive, healthy tank up and running. This will also give all of you a solid chance to see what it looks like in an established tank. Since it's new and we don't know a lot about the surface area properties of this rock, I'm also going to add some marine pier to the sump by cutting 1-inch slabs to fit the entire bottom of the filtration area of the sump and adding blocks to the fuge area. I chose the slabs over the balls because they're easy to remove and clean when needed. I'm going to start the cure today, which is just soaking it in heated salt water with a couple of power heads. Next week, we'll do our aquascape in the tank, add the sand the following week, and I'll do a 100% change before we start cycling this tank. This is ample time to create that biofilm and get anything on the surface of the rock off. So next week, we're going to show you all kinds of aquascaping tips. You seriously don't want to miss out, so hit that subscribe button. If you're interested in learning more about any of these products we talked about in today's video, check out this link for descriptions and user reviews. See you next week with episode 11 of the BRS160 Aquascaping.